About one third of people in Ontario will develop a skin cancer in their lifetime. We know for sure that ultraviolet radiation is the cause of about 90%, 95% of skin cancers.
So it's certainly true that some people are at greater risk of sun damage and skin cancer than others. So the factors that would put you at increased risk would be fair skin, burning easily, blue eyes, fair hair, family history of skin cancer.
You see people in, when you are a practicing dermatologist, you see the devastation that a serious skin cancer can cause.
I also see a tremendous amount of skin cancer, and I have to say over the years I've been struck by the increase in the number of skin cancers that I've been seeing, both basal cell carcinoma and squamous cell carcinoma, as well as melanomas. One of the main ways to protect yourself from the sun is to seek shade.
Children are the most vulnerable age group when it comes to sun and UV rays, and especially when they're in care, because the Day Nurseries Act actually asks them to make sure that children are outside for 2 hours every day. So they, and also when they're young and they're outside and playing, and that proposes a problem when it comes to protection.
The shade policy for the city of Toronto speaks to the fact that shade is a very effective strategy to protect against ultraviolet radiation, overexposure to ultraviolet radiation, and that our agency boards, commissions, and divisions should consider, including the provision of shade, it could be natural, constructed, in their outdoor facilities, especially where children are in attendance.
The shade policy helps bring importance to creating opportunities for shaded seating areas, shaded walking areas, and giving that balance of spaces that the public needs in order to enjoy and fully be comfortable and use the spaces that we're providing for them.
In 2002, Children's Services was invited to the public health table when they decided it was important to put together a shade policy committee. And over the years, the information and education brought forward because of that committee has actually introduced a lot of new changes in Children's Services attitude and education when it comes to sun and our most vulnerable population that we care for.
Well, sitting at the Shade Policy Council table is really important for us because working on urban forest issues, we're incredibly excited about the connections between health and the urban forest. And shade can provide UV radiation protection, and trees are a big component of that. We also work with community groups and volunteers to provide stewardship for trees in public spaces, so in parks where shade is so important. Providing stewardship and ongoing care for those trees so they actually grow to maturity and provide the shade that we need. That's part of the role that we play as well.
So the quality of the public realm is really important, again, to the kind of city we want to create. And design is essential to this. And shade plays a role in terms of making people want to walk along a street or sit in a public square or be in a park. If it's a really hot day and the rising climate, increasing temperatures, and with the concerns over urban heat island effect in the city, we all know that we need to cool our city down, and shade is integral to doing this.
There's two kinds of shade, I guess, to be very simple. There's natural shade and constructed shade. And so any successful shade project involves a combination of natural shade, mostly trees, and constructed shade, structures that are either permanent or temporary, that are somehow located so that they can prevent UV rays from reaching children at play, people sitting on park benches, or just enjoying recreation outdoors.
Urban forestry promotes the planting of large growing native trees wherever possible. Larger trees, often with denser canopies, will provide shade.
This site was one of the sites that we looked at in our 13 years ago, designing for shade forum.
As a pilot project in 2005, we conducted a shade audit of two city parks, Christie Pitts and Charles G. Williams, and the purpose of that project was to outline a methodology for a simple shade audit at minimal cost.
So Nathan Phillips Square is Toronto's most important urban public space. It's an iconic modern space and really represents Toronto's kind of birth into the modern age. It's visited by millions of people a year, and it really hosts such a great diversity of events. It was actually in fall of 2006, the city issued an international design competition. Our winning competition scheme really set out to transform Nathan Phillips Square into a much greener space. So that was one primary objective. Another was to return it to some of the design principles that Vilja Ravel, the Finnish architect who designed City Hall, had in mind. And that was the creation of really an urban theater, a space of infinite public potential.
One of the key projects that we had a big role in was the development of the shade guidelines. And we felt, and the Shade Policy Committee felt, that this would be a great document to have in place that a range of users would be able to use in understanding the importance of shade, the health risks around ultraviolet radiation, and to begin to get a sense of how we could begin to implement shade in the city facilities and city spaces. So it would be a good guidebook, you know, to help people that are working on projects.
Not all trees provide equal shade, so we give information about the types of trees that would provide more shade. We give some tips on what to look for, so the location, the soil type, the moisture levels, and looking at the areas where they need to focus on providing shade to make sure that the placement of the trees will actually optimize shade provision.
One of the key parts of the shade guidelines was to actually put in place guidelines, design guidelines around a number of types of facilities and spaces in the City of Toronto, and these ranged from park spaces, trails, wading pools, swimming pools, playgrounds, especially those kind of areas where youth and young children were active, because we knew we had to place priority on protecting them. As well, we included streetscapes and urban squares, even things like parking lots, so that all the City of Toronto divisions and agencies that had responsibility for those types of spaces could have a guidebook, you know, to help them in their planning and design of these, improving these facilities.
The existence of the shade policy guideline that was created through the policy committee has helped Evergreen to expand their efforts to improve and increase shade on school grounds across Canada. So that work is incredibly important, because we're finding that in some of our anecdotal research that children are more active when the school grounds are shaded and cooler. And what that has stimulated is this effort in each of the cities across Canada where our associates are. It stimulated a conversation with municipalities and is actually creating a groundswell of support in those cities to create their own policies.
So we had a staff team of landscape architects, planners, and construction coordinators. We teamed up with Victor Ford and Associates, which is a private landscape firm. And we took the shade guidelines and applied them at a number of parks, forestry, and recreation sites. So we looked at playgrounds, swimming pools, splash pads, and wading pools. We had a design charrette where we got everyone together and really went through a planning exercise to figure out what would be the types of shade that would be appropriate at each different types of sites. And in order to incorporate that shade, what were the design principles that you needed and the specifications for those specific products. So we looked at natural shade, using shade sails, constructed picnic shelters, retractable awnings, pergolas, as well as a number of different other methods of shade provision. And we really designed a shade provision design standard for parks, forestry, and recreation. The idea is that we want to make planning for shade easy for people to do and fun, and take a lot of the background research out of it so that implementation can happen a lot quicker.
What we're learning, and the World Health Organization is advocating the development of these inclusive, holistic approaches towards disease prevention.
As a longtime city employee, we often get stuck in the silos of our own divisions, and this has really been about blending and cross-pollinating ideas and complementary streams of research. So being able to be excited and informed by what's going on by healthy public policy as far as their healthy by design research initiatives, their heat vulnerability, and of course the shade work, and how that has in turn informed how urban forestry has put that health messaging into their strategic forest management plan, into their active operational planting plans, looking at heat vulnerability data, and of course the shade supplement and the shade guidelines.
We have more to do. We have to learn about better ways to get our message across because it's so important, because so much of skin cancer is preventable.
We have to do, I think, a better job of educating the public of the importance of the shade, the importance of having those kinds of streets that we all want to be on because we all benefit. Real estate values go up. The ecological benefits of having a mature shade tree.
People, when they're very hot and looking for a refuge, they don't want to go to the cooling centers provided. They would much prefer to be in shady parkland.
I think what's significant about the shade policy and the way that it played into the Nathan Phillips Square project is that from the outset, it was so integrated into the city's vision for the square and into the design competition brief, so that it wasn't an overlay or an afterthought.
Everybody needs a shade policy at an individual level and at a community level and at a worker level, because the sun in Toronto is very strong over the summer months.
I was actually excited to be involved in such a project because as a dermatologist, we see the end result. We don't see the prevention aspect that much.
Having a diverse group of individuals sitting on that shade policy committee, it's enabled all of us, I think, to move forward in ways we could never have done individually.
It's been a pleasure to work with such an incredibly dedicated committee.
I think that was one of the great strengths of the shade policy committee, you know, was to bring these multiple viewpoints and strengths and experiences, you know, to the committee and help create a strong policy and the guidelines to now begin to influence the implementation of projects, you know, across the city.
Well, the shade policy, I mean, it's a robust set of principles. I think it can easily be adapted and adopted by other municipalities who are perhaps not as far advanced in their planning tools or their ambitions for urban transformation.
We're the largest city in Canada and the first city in Canada to have a comprehensive policy that talks about shade. So we're being watched and we're also being consulted and we're also looking to others for their experience too.
The support from Toronto Public Health and Toronto Board of Health has been simply invaluable in allowing us to achieve a shade policy and guidelines for the City of Toronto.